Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. Paul's, first Sunday in Lent. I just want to add a preface to the worship before we formally begin. Today, first Sunday in Lent, in the old liturgical traditions of the church, the 40 days of Lent actually began with first Sunday in Lent. Then along the way, they added several fast days to prepare us for the journey of Lent. Thus, Ash Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and the Saturday morning afternoon, first Sunday of Lent, beginning with the evening of Saturday. It's fine that traditions grow and change, but a subtle shift, or not so subtle shift, occurs with that addition. Ash Wednesday, it's all about us, right? Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And that's appropriate for fasting and penitence. But in the original layout of the journey, first Sunday in Lent, it's not about us. It's all about Christ, as you'll hear in the gospel lesson today, his 40-day journey in the wilderness, his journey into the fullness of his ministry that will lead him to the cross. I'm always sensitive to that shift. Whenever it starts shifting more to us than to Christ, more about our sin, our guilt, our this, our that. And then we are at risk for not having the deep, full focus that we might need to be on Christ. Because of his journey in the wilderness, we know he's with us in our journey. So I lift that up so that especially today, your focus might be on Christ. Some quiet moments, then we'll ask you to stand as we begin with a silent procession. Please stand. We can begin, Stacy. We sing, "A mighty fortress is our God," stanza 1 and 2.
Thank you. Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. God of heaven and earth, you come in close and make us yours. Equip us by your Spirit to confess our sin, embrace your forgiveness, and seek the way you set before us in your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
With honesty of heart, let us confess our sin. You may kneel or sit. Merciful God, forgive us. Our will is handcuffed to sin, and we cannot break free. We have spoken, and we should have kept quiet. We were silent, and we should have said something. We acted when we knew better. We were still when we know we should have moved. For the wrong we have done, for the good we have failed to do, have mercy on us, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
People of God, look to the Son, given to heal you and set you free, because God loved the world so much. Take hold of life. Eternal life. Amen. Stand.
Thank you.
you. And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all the forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together for the call committee and its support teams. God of wisdom, in your goodness, you continue to raise up faithful leaders to serve your church. Direct the members of our call committee and the teams that support their work. Help them to discern on our behalf a new faith formation director to guide us in our mission in this place, that we may move forward together in mission. Amen. You may be seated.
Pieces down at the bottom. Nobody would see. Nobody would see. Nobody would know. We could sneak them right now. We could eat it before everybody else. Not a good idea, right? Not a good idea. Even if nobody sees, they can hear us, I think. But even if nobody could see, it's not a good idea, is it? And the really crazy thing about it is you're going to get the communion bread pretty soon, right? You're going to get the communion bread in what, half an hour or so? Half an hour or so, God's got this great meal planned for you. So why? Why would we go and try to take it early? But that's how temptation works sometimes. That's how temptation works sometimes. In our story today, the devil comes to Jesus. And the devil tries to get Jesus to take some things that God's planning to give to Jesus anyways. You know, the devil says, you know, God would want you to have food. God would want you to have food, and God would want you to be protected, and God wants you to rule. Just do it now instead of doing it when God wants it for you. But God has this knowledge. God has this knowledge, and God has this plan. And God knows that there's a time and a place to share things. God knows that there are all of these wonderful things that he wants us to have. But God wants to give us those things when we're ready to receive them. Like with this bread. God doesn't want us to just have this bread whenever. God wants us to have this bread together. God wants us to have this bread together with everybody else in the church. God wants us to receive Jesus. God wants us to receive Jesus with this bread. So God wants us to do things, and God wants us to trust him. God wants us to trust him to provide these things at the perfect time. And like I said, the perfect time for this bread is going to be a little bit later, a little over a half hour probably. And then we'll all come together and we'll share in this meal. Can you pray with me? Lord God, help us to be patient. Help us to trust when we are tempted to take matters into our own hands, when we're tempted to seize that which you are preparing to give us before it's time. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
First reading this morning is a reading from Genesis. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the tree in the garden, but God said you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
Our psalmody. Happy are they whose transgressions are forgiven and whose sin is put away. While I held my tongue, my bones withered away because of my groaning all day long. I acknowledged my sin to you, did not conceal my guilt. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. Then you forgave me the guilt of my sin. You are my hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. Not be like horse or mule, which have no understanding, who must be fitted with bit and bridle, or else they will not stay near you. Be glad, you righteous, and rejoice in the Lord. Shout for joy, all who are true of heart.
Second lesson this morning is a reading from Romans. Just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all because all have sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgressions of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespasses. For if the many died through one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift and the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And the free gift is not like the effect of one man's sin. For the judgment following one's trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If, because of one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those receive an abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's transgression led to the condemnation for all, so the one man's act of righteousness leads to the justification and life for all. For just as by one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Please stand. Gospel according to St. Matthew in the 4th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." And then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." And Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give to you, if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only
him. And then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise
you, O Christ. You may be seated. The peace of the Lord be with you. Year before I was ordained, Dana and I joined a weight loss Bible study program at the church where I was working. Now, the overall point of this ministry was a great thing, at least on the surface. It was a group that met each week, and we would be accountable to each other. We'd build each other up, support each other in our goals with healthy eating, self-care, and exercise, goal of losing weight. And each week, all of that would get reinforced with Bible readings and discussion questions and messages about the spiritual implications of the foods that we eat. There were a lot of really helpful elements to that program. But there was this thing about that program that really drove me nuts about it. And by the end of it, it kind of made it hard to take it very seriously. And that was the way that the program talked about Satan and temptation. Now, I know and understand, I think all of us understand and appreciate that to boost our willpower, there's a lot of things that we tell ourselves as a way of motivation. Well, this series talked about cake or sweets or cookies, sugary things, desserts, snacks. It treated them as objects of spiritual warfare. Now, I suppose you could say that if God's desire for us in general is to be healthy and to make healthy choices, then Satan would want the opposite. So if God wants us to be disciplined and deny some forms of indulging, then Satan, I guess, would be telling us, eat that pie, order that ice cream. But the whole thing just started to sound really, really simplistic. Not to mention the fact that it painted this picture and kind of had this impression about it, that if there was a food that gave you pleasure, and that food wasn't like asparagus or grapes, not that those can't be pleasurable foods, but if those foods weren't fruits or vegetables, carrots, apples, that it wasn't a part of God's design. That there was this list of foods that were godly and this list of foods that were not godly. I think sometimes in terms of how we process our life, I think we find it helpful to just classify things in that way. To classify the devil as having these tools and these domains and these areas to work in. And then God's got these other tools, different areas, different strategies to work from. But the thing is, it's not nearly that simple. Not to mention the fact that when we allow ourselves to think in those terms, we forget that all of it belongs to God. That all of this is God's territory. Interestingly, the wilderness was kind of treated as this God-forsaken area in the time of Christ. So makes sense in a way that was where he would experience this temptation, where he would encounter Satan. The wilderness was often a place that was thought of as dangerous. It was often where people went off to when they could no longer be a part of the religious community. So Jesus obviously encounters Satan there, but even that area, and one of the things that is accomplished through this passage is that even that area is known by God, is loved by God, and is claimed by God. But it wasn't as simple. It wasn't that simple when Jesus was tempted. It wasn't as simple as saying there's these tools and these areas that belong to God and these other things that belong to Satan. Similar to the description of Satan's way of operating in the famous book, The Screwtape Letters, by C.S. Lewis. The Christ encounters Satan and temptation not as this dark, nefarious, grotesque force that is luring Jesus into acts of hatred and cruelty, but as a voice that offers the sorts of reasonable suggestions that we'd almost expect from Jesus' family and followers. In the temptations that are placed before the Lord while in the wilderness, he's invited to draw on the power of God, not to stuff himself by eating an entire cake, but to summon his powers to just provide a little bit of relief for himself. He's invited to draw on the powers of God, not to harm anything. The devil doesn't even ask him to step on a spider, but to establish his identity by calling the angels into action to rescue him from a great fall. And the third invitation, to display the sort of power and authority that the people who will come to follow him, the sort of authority that they'd been hoping for, that they'd been waiting to see happen. To bring peace through a temporary but all-encompassing earthly reign. Jesus is in the wilderness, he's hungry, he's humbled, and he's alone. Satan invites him to be fed, to be exalted, and to be great. But in those reasonable, almost generous gifts, Jesus is being asked to deny his obedience to God. Jesus is being asked to deny his role as a servant. And Jesus is being asked to remove himself from the time and the place where God has placed him to grow and to be strengthened and to be nurtured in the faith, as oftentimes temptation does for us. There's this great passage in the book where the mentoring demon, whose name is Screwtape, explains to his young apprentice, Wormwood, that to see a human being brought to a low point is not necessarily a cause to celebrate, as that is when the enemy, God is referred to in this book as the enemy all the time, the enemy can sometimes do the most change in a person's life and do the most to build faith in those moments. See, there's this passage where Wormtail has responded and is really feeling encouraged at the fact that someone is in the wilderness, as Jesus is described. But his mentor says this, and he refers to the troughs as the low points in life and the peaks as the high points in life. Now, it may surprise you to learn that in his efforts to get permanent possession of a soul, God relies on the troughs even more than the peaks. Some of his special favorites have gone through longer and deeper troughs than anyone else. The reason is this: to us, a human is primarily food. But the obedience which the enemy demands of men is quite a different thing. One must face the fact that all of the talk about his love for men and his service being perfect freedom is not just propaganda, but is an appalling truth. He really does want to fill the universe, with replicas of himself. Not because he has absorbed them, but because their wills freely conform to his. We want cattle who can finally become food. He wants servants who can finally become sons. We want to suck in. He wants to give out. We are empty and would be filled. He is full and flows over. And there is where the troughs come in. You must have often wondered why the enemy does not make more use of his power to be sensibly present to human souls in any degree he chooses and at any moment, as the devil calls on Jesus to assume in the temptation in the wilderness. But his scheme forbids him to use his power in those ways. Merely to override a human's will would be for him useless. He cannot ravish. He can only woo. For his ignoble idea is to eat the cake and have it. The creatures are to be one with him, but yet still themselves. He is prepared to do a little overriding at the beginning. But sooner or later, he leaves the creature to stand up on its own legs, to carry out from the will alone. It is during such trough periods, much more than during the peak periods, that it is growing into the sort of creature God wants it to be. So while the tempter's invitations to Jesus seem reasonable, they're not only an invitation to submit to the Prince of Darkness, but they're also an invitation to abandon the cross. To abandon the truth that in our times of suffering, loss, and dread, our Lord meets us and our Lord carries us through. And that this peace and this victory doesn't start after the hard times cease, after the dark clouds have disappeared. It starts when we are still in the middle of it and we hold fast to our trust in God to be our strength. It starts when we don't settle for shortcuts, when we choose not to blame others, when we choose not to deny responsibility, when we choose not to lash out, even when those things would be the easiest response and most comfortable thing for us to do. Likewise, we can sometimes find it appealing to seek a way out through our own understanding, to get security from other sources of strength, to be fed by truths and values and mindsets that are just easier and simpler to stomach. Such things might even give us something that feels a little bit like the life that God talks about. Feels a little bit like good news, but it won't be all that we can find when we turn to him and encounter him and embrace the life that he offers. And the life that he offers is a life that the temptations, strangely enough, allude to a little bit, but offer in a way that is thoroughly incomplete. But in the temptations, Jesus is asked to create bread, multiply bread to satisfy hunger. We've heard that story before. He would do that, but not for his sake, not for his own hunger, but for the sake of those who were hungering and thirsting for God's mercy and truth. The devil challenges the Lord to fall mightily. Our Lord would fall mightily in the garden on the night of his arrest. And he would fall often on his way to the cross. And when he fell in the garden, and when he fell on the way to the cross, angels did attend to him. God's strength and power did bear him up. God did intervene in those times, but not to deliver him from dashing his foot against a stone, but helping him move forward, helping him with that confrontation against sin and death. Satan lifts the Lord up to see all the kingdoms of the world, and our Lord would be lifted up and exalted to have dominion over the nations of the world. But he would be lifted up by nails and wood. And in all of these moments, the power of God would flow from him, not for his own sake, but for the sake of others. Which I guess makes all the difference. Because the ways leading to death or to life are not known by being so completely different and opposite from each other. They're known in those details. They're known in those details. They're set apart in those details of whether going a certain way is marked by self-importance or if it's marked by servanthood. If it comes at the expense of others or builds others up. Does it isolate us or does it create community? To paraphrase the Apostle Paul from Corinthians in reference to the temptations that Jesus faces, if I call on my divinity to make a divine feast, but have not the love made known by sharing it with others, my request is a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I call on my Father to deliver me from being wounded or broken while my neighbor sits bleeding and oppressed and forgotten, I am nothing. If I bring forth a power that gives me dominion over all the earth to drive out the tyrants of this world, but I leave my children burdened by the power of sin and death that terrorizes them and that robs them of their peace and of my kingdom, I gain nothing. At the heart of the temptation faced by Jesus, and in a sense at the heart of most temptations that we have that draw us from fellowship and life with God and one another, is an invitation to take a path that appears real enough but that is lacking in love. In the love that we confess, in the love that we stand for with our lives and our faith. And lacking such love, those temptations are nothing. Peace be with you. Amen. We stand and sing.
Thank you.
Let us confess our faith, speaking the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our intercessory response is, Your mercy is great. Lifting our voices and turning toward God, let us pray for the church, the earth, and all who are in need. Holy God, in this sacred season of Lent, lead your church to walk with you, to do your will, to strive for your kingdom. Hear us, O God. In this springtime of the church year, we thank you for favorable weather. We ask that you show us the way to care for your good creation, to treasure the fruits of your creating. Hear us, O God. Gracious God, you gave David courage to lead and to seek your will. Give knowledge and wisdom to all leaders throughout your world to seek your will, to show courage in doing right. Hear us, O God. Gracious God, you know the needs of your people. Come to the aid of those who are in distress. Send your peace and healing to all in need, especially for those we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the ministries of our church. We ask your blessing especially upon the worship ministries in this season of Lent. Bless our preschool and our child care. Bless the new ministry that uses our church, of God is Love, Dios es Amor. We welcome them this weekend to our chapel. Hear us, O God. Now accompany us in our journey. Inspire us by the witness of all the saints who have gone before us. Hear us, O God. Into your hands, merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast love through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We share the gift of peace.
Merciful God, receive the sacrifice of our praise and thanksgiving and the offering of our lives, that following in the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all of the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Son, Jesus Christ, when you gave him to save us from our sin, your Spirit led him into the wilderness, where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights in preparation for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross for our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, when we, your people, gather for the yearly Paschal feast of your Son's death and resurrection, you lead us to repentance for our sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days we may be gifted and graced to renew the covenant you made with us through Christ. It was on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in prayer and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. We join with one another as a family of faith as we pray as our Savior taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. be seated. All who thirst, all who hunger, come and be filled with the goodness of God. All are welcome.
Thank you. Please stand. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer a song of grateful hearts. To Jesus. And now may God, who has called us forth from the dust of the earth and claimed us as children of the light, strengthen you on your journey into life renewed. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Marked with the cross of Christ, go forth to love and serve the Lord.